You would claim that this world model is the first of its kind, and you have the data from it that proves its effectiveness. But the main point is validation of a capability without collecting the real world data.
Kind of, yes. You got it mostly right. So what it really does is it gives us the ability to basically see the future with respect to what would happen if the robot actually takes these specific actions. And this allows us to really test at scale whether these new AI models that we're actually creating will be better than the previous ones, right? And that really allows us to climb this and really to create better and better AI models for physical labor.
I wrote in the Tech in Depth newsletter this morning that if you look at particularly manufacturing jobs data, that there is a need there. You know, it's hard to fill those roles. Why does this world model open a path to a world where humanoid robotics are genuinely useful, deployable in manufacturing or other logistics settings where a human is currently needed?
So I think, like, taking a step back to us, like, you know, we're a consumer company seen often as right now, but to us it's really about how do you create an actual abundance of artificial labor as quickly as possible, which means going into factories, going into enterprise services, and basically everything, right? But to get there and get your robots to be intelligent enough to solve these tasks, you just need this incredible diversity of data. And that's why we're going to the home first. And if you're deploying these robots at scale into homes, living and learning among us, then we also need to be able, in a safe manner, to test how will our models perform. And this is really what the world model allows us to do. It allows us to take all of this data that we're gathering, create new models, and then see if we deployed these to our fleet of robots, how would it actually perform? Would all of the behaviors that it do actually be safe? Would it be able to do things it couldn't do before? And kind of really benchmark the models so we can progress.
How sophisticated is the hardware right now? We're talking about how the models and the software is going to really bring it to bear. What are they already doing in the home, those that are out in beta?
So the hardware is actually really getting there. So I have one in my home, for example, and it's doing like tidying, cleaning, vacuuming, some laundry, different kind of tasks around the home. And of course, also the social aspect of this, right? Being able to have this AI companion together with you, which doesn't actually require you to look at your phone all the time to be able to interface with AI. Mm-hmm. Now, currently, this is still pretty brittle, and the magic is there, and then maybe it lasts for a minute, and then you need someone to nudge it in the right direction, right? But it's really getting to where you see where this will go. And the hardware can do it, and now it's really about how do we gather the data that allows us to automate all this behavior. And that's also really what we're doing this year, right? So when we're talking about the goal being by end of year, we're actually going to have this commercially out in the market in homes. It's really important to do expectation management, because this is not the consumer product at that point that everyone will have at home. This is the beginning of a journey where we're inviting people in on our mission to really almost like adopt a Neo into your family, have it live and learn among us, and have a lot of fun along the way.
Okay, but so you're pitching,
of course,
the
it's still early
adopter
adopters.
Here, basically, yeah. Bernt. You're pitching an early adopter in the home. Go to outside the home for a moment. I really want your expertise. When we're talking about having robots help manufacture here in the US, President Trump wants to build Apple phones here in the US. Is robotics at a level in the next few years where we could ever make that achievable?
In the next few years. I think, like, this is going to happen a lot sooner than people might think, but it's not happening this year. But we are a few years, not a few decades, away from where, actually, most importantly to me, robots can build robots, meaning we can have robots build more robots. We can have robots build out the energy infrastructure, the data centers, the chip fabs, and really enable us to get this multiplier on the workforce for artificial labor, which will allow us to automate all kinds of factory work across the US. And I think this can have a tremendous impact on our GDP, right? And how we can grow our way out of the current deficit. But I also want to just do expectation management and say, right, like, this is years away. But years is not that long in the grand picture of things. It's not decades.
You first came on our radar at NVIDIA GTC. You had this sort of very prominent place, and I know that the 1X exchanged jackets with Jensen, etc. What is the unlock been from NVIDIA? You know, they always talk about how they work in multiple ways, not just providing the basis for training, but the localized silicon for the robot itself, and then simulated or virtual data? Just explain the relationship.
Yeah, sure. Like, NVIDIA is an amazing partner, right? And we're working very deeply together, both with their engineering team. We're using their hardware. We're using their simulators. And I think they've done an incredible job in just enabling the ecosystem. And all of the things you touched upon, we are using, right? So they're very fast simulators that allow us to learn a lot in simulation before we have to go into the real world. It's really valuable for us. We had some great results we published last week from our reinforcement learning and our work on how to like use the entire body. Like you can see here, the robot actually using its entire body to do tasks. And this is trained in NVIDIA simulators. The compute on board the robot actually is NVIDIA's hardware, and right. They've done a great job in creating very good embedded compute that can allow us to run the robot fully kind of enclosed, right? It doesn't actually need to be connected to the internet to do its tasks. And of course, we're training on the infrastructure from NVIDIA like everyone else, right?
We're talking a lot about your model, world model today, but we're showing also pictures on the screen of the hardware side. What is different? What is your different mission statement to a figure AI, agility, Tesla and Optimus, all the things we've been talking about for many weeks?
Sure. So, of course, I don't want to speak on others' behalf, but I can say, like, my view on this. So I'd actually say it's pretty different because most of the companies in this field, they're focusing on how can we be useful as quickly as possible in manufacturing or some kind of enterprise. While to me, it's actually all about how can we make robots that are safe so they can live and learn among people, because that's how we get to truly intelligent machines. And if you want to put them in consumer, they need to be extremely affordable. So you need to have this combination of something that's very safe, but still affordable and very capable. And then you can have this living and learning among people and basically solve the full problem, right? How do we get robots that are as intelligent as us so that we can easily instruct them in how to do labor across society at scale? So I say, like, we're betting to go directly to the goal instead of going through the factories.